Dear students, let us discuss another topic, that is evolution of urinogenital duct invertebrates. It is the last topic of your third unit of semester second of undergraduate course of zoology according to syllabus of University of Jammu. Myself Sarshad Hussain from Government Degree College, Sunkot. Basically, you know there are two systems in your body which are called, one of them is called the reproductive system and other one is called the urinary system. Both have different functions. Reproductive systems has a function of perpetuation of the species, that means continuity of the species in the coming generations, whereas the urinary system is affiliated with the excretion of the nitrogenous waste from the body. However, these two systems are morphologically, though they are different functionally, totally different functionally, but morphologically invertebrates, particularly in case of the male, the urinary ducts are performing both the functions, that is they are performing the function of discharging the gametes also in addition to their functions of carrying the urine. So, due to this reason, the reproductive system and the urinary system invertebrate is together studied as urogenital or urinogenital system, means it is a combination of urinary system and genital, means the reproductive system of the body. And you all know that the vertebrates, they show sexual mode of reproduction and in them male and females are separate. The condition is called dioecious. There are few exceptions where they are not dioecious, like the hagfishes and few bony fishes. So, when both the sexes are present within the same individuals, the conditions you know is called the hermaphrodite. Hermaphrodite is a condition opposite to the dioecious, or you can also call them monoecious. Reproductive glands are the gonads, you know, you have the, in the reproductive system, you have the reproductive gonads, the reproductive glands. In male, these glands and gonads are called testes, and in male, these testes will produce the sperm. In female, the glands or gonads are called the ovaries, and their function is the production of egg or the ova. So, in the embryo, gonad originate as a pair of thick elevated folds or genital ridge of coelomic epithelium from the roof of coelom. You can see this is the coelom, the body cavity, this is the roof of the coelom. From the roof of the coelom, you can see that the ridges are there, these ridges are there which are called the, these ridges, they are called the genital ridges. So, how they have developed? They have developed as a fold from the roof of the cavity. And they basically, if you look at the longitudinal section, it is basically a longitudinal ridge, you can say. Okay? And they are present on both the sides of the gut, or you can say the dorsal mesentery. Dorsal mesentery is the organ that hang down the gut from the dorsal wall. So, they are present on both the side of the gut or the dorsal mesentery, you can say. Genital ridge are much longer than the functional adult gonads. So, this was the condition in the embryo during the course of development. they are having very large size. They are long enough, but in the adult you will not find that the testes and the ovaries will be having such long structure. So as compared to the adult, genital ridges are much larger, much longer. Now this suggests that the ancestral vertebrates, in the ancestral vertebrates, the gonads extends the whole length of pleuroperitoneal cavity. This cavity is called the pleuroperitoneal cavity. So because of their longitudinal occurrence, you can say that whole of the cavity was having a long genital ridge in the pleuroperitoneal cavity. Now, the functional adult gonads is derived from the middle or the gonal part of genital ridge. So, you can imagine that this is the middle portion. The adult gonads are short, they are not long enough. So, only the middle part is contributing to the formation of the gonads. This middle part is called the gonal part or the middle part. The anterior one, which is present anterior to the gonal, is called the progonal, and the posterior is called the postgonal. So, the anterior progonal and the posterior epigonal both become sterile in the adult. That means they will not function in the adult. This long ridge is functional only in case of the embryos. Now, gonads remain suspended in coelom from dorsal body wall by a fold of dorsal mesentery. Again, as dorsal mesentery was enclosing this gut, similarly dorsal mesentery is enclosing the gut also along the dorsal wall of the body, the coelom. And this dorsal mesentery which enclosed the genital ridge or the gonad is called the mesorchium in males and mesovrium in the females. So, the mesentery encircling the testes is the mesorchium, and the mesentery encircling the ovaries is called the mesovrium. So, mesentery basically hang the these testes and the ovaries with the wall of the body. Generally, one pair of gonad is present in all the vertebrates mostly. There are few exceptions where the genital ridges fuses, like in case of the cyclostomes, in the perch and in other fishes. So, once they fuse, then there will be only one gonad, or sometimes one of them may degenerate. So, like in hagfishes, some lesmobranchs, lizards, alligator and most birds, one of the ridge degenerate. As a result, in the adult you will find only single gonad. Associated with the gonads are special gonoducts or the genital ducts. So, you can see this is the gonad, testis in case of male, ovary in case of female. Associated with them are some certain ducts. These ducts are called the genital ducts or the vas deferentia in males. You can see this is called the vas deferentia in male and oviduct in case of the female, are also called as Mullerian duct. So, ducts are associated with the primary sex organs called the gonads, the testes and the ovaries, in order to carry the secretion of these to a particular portion where it is needed. Say, for example, to carry the sperms produced inside the testes and to carry the egg produced inside the ovaries. Let us first of all look at the evolution of the urinary genital duct in case of the male. So, if you look at the male, the testes of vertebrates are paired organs, as I have already told you, in most of the cases, and is remain attached to the kidney in almost all the vertebrates. You can see this was the kidney, the black one. it is very much near to the kidney and remains associated with most of the kidney, most of the vertebrates with the kidney, but only in the mammals, some mammals, these testes descend down into extra abdominal skin called the scrotal sac. In rest of the vertebrates, it remains inside the body with the kidney. Though you know the testes produce the sperms, and the sperms are communicated through genital duct to cloaca. So this is the cloaca, the openings through which the excretory material is given outside from the body, and then these ducts are basically carrying the sperms to the cloaca. In cyclostomes, genital duct is not present. So sperms are released in the cilium, from where they pass through the abdominal pores present in the cilium. So if the duct is not present over there, say for example in the cyclostomes, then the sperm will just come out in the body cavity, and the posterior pore is present in the body cavity, which will communicate the sperm to the outside. In most anamniotes, anamniotes are those organisms which lives in water mostly. The mesonephros is differentiated into anterior genital and posterior renal portion. So you can see, because this posterior portion of this urinogenital duct, which is also called as a mesonephric duct or also called the Wolfian duct, is associated with the kidney. So it is taking the excretory material from the kidney, whereas the anterior part is linked with the testes to take the sperm, to carry the sperms to the duct, the mesonephric duct. In the anterior genital portion in males, some uriniferous tubules lose excretory functions. Say for example, this uriniferous tubule, which was earlier present with the kidney, now it has no connection with the kidney, and it has established this connection direct with the testis. So hence, now it is called the vas afferentia. Earlier it was the urinogenital duct. Now it is the vas afferentia, and it will communicate the sperm from the seminiferous tubules of the testis through these ducts to the mesonephric duct present behind. Vasa afferentia serves to carry sperms that I have already told you from the testes to the mesonephric duct of the kidney. Now here you can see that in the male, the Wolfian duct or the mesonephric duct or the urogenital duct is carrying both the things, that is excretory material from the kidney as well as the sperms from the testes. Hence now it is rightly to call it as a urinogenital system. So the duct is urinogenital duct. However, in case of the dogfishes, accessory urinary duct drain urine from the kidney to cloaca, so that the mesonephric duct serve entirely as vas deferens. So in case of the dogfish, this single duct is not performing both the function. The mesonephric duct is performing the function of only as a vas deferens to carry the sperm, and in another accessory duct is present along with the kidney, which carry the excretory material to the cloaca. The anterior genital part of the kidney along with the part of mesonephric duct form the epididymis. So because you know, as we are moving from lower vertebrate to higher vertebrates, the anterior part of the kidney will also degenerate. It was pronephros earlier, and then it will become the mesonephros. So the part that is left behind of the kidney and the mesonephric duct that was associated with the kidney, they together constitute the epididymis. Epididymis is, you know, is a tube-like structure that is that receives the sperm from the testis. So in amniotes means the most terrestrial animals like the reptiles, birds and mammals, you know, there is a development of metanephric kidney. So metanephros is there. So it has its own urinary duct or the ureter to transport the urine, Whereas this mesonephric or the Wolffian duct form the vas deferens to carry the sperm received from the vasa afferentia. And again, the remnant of mesonephros and coiled portion of mesonephric duct become the epididymis, as I have already told you. So, this is the remnant of mesonephros, because now it has become the metanephros. Along with this, the mesonephric duct, they form the epididymis. From each testis, sperm is first passed through the epididymis. Epididymis basically is lying a tube lying very close to the testis, then to the vasa afferentia, then to the vasa deferentia, then to the cloaca. Now, let us look now in case of the females. So, we have seen that in the male, testes were attached in most of the vertebrate with the kidney, but ovaries will not get themselves attached with the kidneys in case of the vertebrates. So, eggs are produced in the ovary, and when the eggs will become mature, they are released out internally into the central ovarian cavity. Sometimes there is a cavity present within inside the ovary, like in case of the bony fishes, teleost. So, that cavity remain continues with the oviduct. So, the eggs are communicated through the oviduct, but in most of the vertebrates, this is not the case. The eggs, once get matured, is released into the body cavity, the coelom, outside the ovary, and the process is called the ovulation. In all vertebrate embryos except cyclostomes, the coelomic epithelium on the outside of mesonephric duct develop a groove which becomes closed to form a tube called Mullerian duct. Now, this Mullerian duct get itself originated by having a fold on the dorsal wall of the body cavity, and this fold then get closed, forming a tube called the oviduct or the Mullerian duct. In adult males, this Mullerian duct becomes vestigial, because it starts its formation in the embryo, but in the adult male, it becomes vestigial and functionless, whereas in case of the female, it grow longer and become female genital duct, are called the oviduct. So, oviduct opens into the coelom. You can look at ovaries are there, they will release the egg into the body cavity called coelom, and the oviduct are also opening through the ostium into the body cavity, and this ostium is also called the coelomic funnel, and it terminates posteriorly into the cloaca. Thus, in adult females, in amniotes, both the Mullerian duct as well as the Mullerian duct is called the oviduct, and the Wolffian duct. You can see over there, this is the Wolffian duct, that is mesonephric or urinary duct are present. Now, here there is no combination of both of them. In case of the male, the same Wolffian duct was taking the sperm from the testes at its anterior portion, and from posterior portion it was taking the excretory matter from kidney. Now, both the ducts are totally separate in case of the female, unlike that of the male. In adult females, amniotes with the development of adult metanephric kidney and its duct also, which is called the ureter or the mesonephric duct, or the also called the Wolffian duct. Only vestiges are known. That means, it was the condition previously we have discussed in the anamniotes, the animals which were living in the water. Now, in case of the amniotes, the organisms which are mostly the terrestrial, they are tetrapods. Once the metanephric kidney developed and its ducts, that is ureter, is formed, at that very point of time, the mesonephros and its duct which is called the Mullerian duct, the Wolffian duct degenerate. You can see here are the sign of the degeneration, that it was present earlier over there, but now it is not present over there, and leaving only vestiges known as provarium. So these are basically the provarium, that is vestiges are the remnant of the degenerating mesonephrons and its duct, the Wolffian duct. In VV parasmeval, now what is the difference between earlier one and this one? In earlier one, this was the Mullerian duct, and this was the Wolffian duct. Now what has happened over there? Now the Wolffian duct has degenerated itself. Okay, mesonephric duct Mullerian duct is present over there, which has developed due to the grooving of the wall of the coelom on the dorsal position that we have discussed in the previous slides, but the Wolffian duct has disappeared now, and now the vestiges of it are called the provarium. In case of the egg-laying mammals, posterior end of both the Mullerian duct become fused, because you know testes are present in the gonads are present in pairs. So again, these ducts are present again in the pair, one on the left side, other on the right side. So both of them get fused, that is from the right side and the left side of the body, the Mullerian duct, these one, they get themselves fused and they form the uterus. This is the uterus, which is formed by the, you can see over there particularly, this is the say for example, the anterior portion of the duct coming from the one side, this is from the other side, and then it is uniting to form this uterus. Uterus is the organ where embryo will develop, and then it extends down to form the vagina. This is the portion which will receive the male intromittent organs during copulations, which is popularly called as penis. The remaining anterior part of the oviduct, that means beyond this uterus, it is relatively very short and convoluted, that means coiled, and now it formed the fallopian tube. This portion is called the fallopian tube. Now condition of uterus varies in different mammals, which is as follows. There is one condition which is called the duplex or didelphys. Now what is there? Both the uterus of the both the sides, they have not united themselves, they are separate. This condition is present in the marsupial. Then you are having the bipartite uterus. Here there is a partial fusion of the uterus, so as to form, they have the two horns of the uterus, because lower portion is fused and the above portion is not fused, forming the two horn of the uterus, and but they have the lumen separated internally. So this condition is present in case of hamster and the rabbit, and the condition is called the bipartite uterus. Then you are having the bicoronate uterus, where there are two horns of the uterus present again there, but a cavity is fused again there. Here it was partitioned, but now the cavity is also fused. This condition is present in the ungulates. Then there is a simplex uterus. In the simplex uterus, when the uterine horns are absent, so both the oviduct of both the sides have joined and completely fused themselves with one another, forming a large single internal cavity called the uterus. This condition is present in the primates, bats, and the armadillos. Thanks. This was all about the evolution of the urinogenital duct, as that we have seen that when we were moving from lower condition to the higher condition. So what was happening, that earlier in case of male particularly, the same duct was performing the function of carrying the sperms as well as the excretory material from the kidney, but in the later cases the ureter is developed separately, and the vasa afferentia and vasa deferentia separately, but again before coming out from the body, they again join together to form a single tube, which is called the urethra also. So, which carry both the things, that is the sperm through the same track, and again the excretory material of the kidney through the same track. It is why that this is called the urinogenital systems. Whereas in case of the females, mostly the two systems remain morphologically separate, though functionally both male and female have the separate urinary system and the reproductive system, you can say. Thanks.